I would like to welcome one of the National Symphony's finest artists. Tonight is a milestone for him as well. After 53 years with the orchestra, he will be retiring at the end of the season. Ladies and gentlemen, principal cellist John Martin performing Alexander Glazunov's Chant du Ménestrel.
John Martin, a 53-year veteran of the National Symphony Orchestra, who in 1994 retired as principal cellist, died in 2005 at the age of 82. The son of an Army bandmaster, John joined the NSO in 1941 at just 18 years of age. At the time, he was studying the cello with Howard Mitchell, the principal cellist of the National Symphony, who would recommend that John restudy the instrument with Gregor Piatigorsky after serving 4 years during World War II. In John's first season in February 1941, Mitchell conducted the National Symphony Orchestra in Bloch's Shlomo, with Martin as soloist. Two would pair up again on the same work 10 years later, this time with John in his superior role as principal, a position he held for almost 50 years. With trial and tribulation, the shy, introverted cellist would rediscover and reinvent himself under Piatigorsky's tutelage. The famous cellist's class small and full of future stars. Lauren Monroe, Paul Olefsky, Shirley Treppel, and Bobby Sayers. In the summer of 1987, when the following 45-minute interview took place, post-concert on tour with Rostropovich, John had many days to think about his mentor, Piatigorsky. With impeccable memory, his famous and infamous acerbic side pours forth. John was extremely tall and distinguished looking, with long arms and a quick step and a noble brow. What riveted so many for more than half a century was the way he played. Not just his solos, which were thrilling, but the way he played everything. He had a way of leading, a style of showing just by the quirky hoist and stretch of his distinguished left hand, a lifting of his head, a turn of his shoulder, a marked beating with his head or foot. What the piece expressed, what the music was all about. He was so demonstrative, yet elegantly into it. In fact, at times he was too demonstrative for some fellow cellists who thought him stagey. Our age difference quelled any competitive undertones. Our relationship respectful, supportive, and affable. Of course, John's overflowing humor about life, disarmed all uneasy situations. "You know," John would say, passing by me upon the completion of a demeaning Pops rehearsal, "remember, this is the big time." John Martin's power, passion, and unique style of cello playing, and humor, that's what I will remember. "You were brilliant, John, and I only played with you for 10 seasons, when you were confident, accurate, and strong. All of this literally under the nose of Mstislav Rostropovich, the most brilliant cellist in our history. Indeed, John, he loved your originality. And yes, John, you were acerbic, which I think you got away with because of your seniority. Once interrupting a chagrined, well-respected conductor, you leaned forward and asked, 'Are you following me, or am I following you?' Much to the delight of us younger cellists in the section, you turned around and said, 'Never give up the opportunities to control the tempo.'"
Born in Washington.
Right there, and Walter Reed, three strikes against me right from the beginning. I was an Army brat. So anyway, I listened to the Air Force over at Bowling Field, which is now is no longer there, but it was across the river from the National Airport. They put me to work in the greenhouse. I was rolling officers' lawns. There was a war going on in Africa and everywhere else, and here I was rolling lawns. I couldn't believe it, and they were running a big numbers racket in the back room. At that time, I had no idea what they were doing, but after I saw the Phil Silver show, I knew that's what they were doing. They were running a numbers game. And then they put me on this crew that took care of airplanes. And my job was to put the chocks under the wheels, hold the fire extinguisher when the plane started up, carry officers' luggage, things like that. I was a porter.
Uh-huh.
I mean, there's a bunch of shit. And then they said, "Well, gee, why don't you try for the band?" So I tried to fake my way on a wind instrument. That didn't work.
This is your 43rd season with the National Symphony?
Well, I joined them in 41. And I was out...
27.
I was out for about 4 years. This is 87? 41 from 87 is God knows how much. That's 46, isn't it? I joined the orchestra 46 years ago. But then World War II, I was out, and I went to a year to Curtis. That's the year I studied with Piatigorsky. But it was right after the war. I was 23. 19 and 23. Boy, that's a valuable time to miss. I figured I'd learn how to play cello again. So anyway, I applied, and I was the only one taken that year. It was a lean year.
Do you remember what you played?
Yeah. I hacked my way through the Lalo.
Did he hear the whole thing?
They don't usually, but you see, you're supposed to prepare a concerto, etude, Bach, and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
I didn't do any of that stuff. I played a movement of the Lalo, and he said, "Okay, let's hear some Bach." And I said, "I don't have any Bach. Prepare it," he said. "Supposed to have Bach. I haven't got any Bach." Second. and I took that damn thing so fast.
Do you remember approximately how many times you saw him that year?
Yes, exactly. He was on the contract to the Curtis Institute to give 20 lessons. It so happens, I counted up, the school year was about 4 months. And there were lots of holidays, Valentine's Day, you name it, Christmas, 2 weeks. It was a very short period of time that you were actually in there doing business. And he had to give 20 lessons. Now, since he was a concert artist and touring all the time, he'd be gone for 2 or 3 weeks at one time. When he came back, we might have 3 lessons in 1 week, and then he'd be gone again. And
just you one-on-one with him, or were there other students that sat in on your lessons?
One-on-one. Anybody could come in who wanted to, and usually they came in when you were preparing, when you were playing a concerto. I remember I was studying Schumann concerto. I got through it. I loved his cadenza. I wore out a 78 record copying that damn thing down. He was sore as hell. Write your own. He didn't want me to play his, he wouldn't listen to it.
Was he at this time now?
He was about 45.
45, so he was really playing all over the world.
Yeah, yeah. So all the kids who were lined up tiptoed out. Left me alone. And he gave me a real lecture on maybe there was something else I wanted to do besides play cello, you know, and all that sort of stuff.
This had to crush you.
All the guys got over the school like wildfire. I thought I was going to be thrown out of the school. Guys came over and we all got drunk and cried and everything practically. Now, it wasn't for 2 years that I found out that the whole damn thing was a put-up job. He was trying to get me to practice.
It was all in the effort to get you to practice.
Job he had it all, no matter if I had played marvelously, it would have been the same thing. I found out from my wife, who was a friend of the assistant.
How did you think he played?
I thought it was damn good for me. I thought it was pretty good. He didn't like me horsing around all the time. I was fooling around with his assistant, and I was having a good time at school. It was one of the best times of my life. I made lots of friends. And you know, when the teacher's gone all the time, you really have to be self-motivated. So I was very happy when he invited me up to a summer place. I thought that was possible. Not far from Galamian's place. Plattsburgh or something up there.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, he had a big Swiss house on a hill. And what did he do? He lived in the gardener's house down on the highway. He says it suits me better.
Did he teach his way?
You can't tell a Piatigorsky pupil when you hear one. You don't know that he's better. They're all different. It's like our.
Interesting.
He did not want you to imitate him. As a matter of fact, if you came in with an idea, if you played a certain way, he would call you on it. It was okay if you could justify it musically. You could do that, fine. Let's say that you figured the phrase should go this way because of this. Perhaps a harmonic structure or something, you know. I mean, you had to have a reason. You can't just say, well, I feel it this way.
Right. You know, then he would say, good, continue.
No, he'll say, just say, okay. Don't forget, he wasn't a pedagogue like Rhodes. He was a coach. He didn't know how he did things. He was a natural. He always could play.
So he demonstrated every now and then for you.
Oh, only if I made him.
Only if you made him. So he never came to a lesson with his cello.
Oh, no. I remember he gave me a piece by a concerto by Castel Nuevo Tedesco, a Hollywood composer who had lived in Spain. And it was the biggest bunch of crap you ever heard. And it turned out that he played that in about 1937 with Toscanini, although I didn't know it at the time. And I couldn't make head or tail out of that damn piece, and I hated it. And he made all his pupils play that thing. Then I studied little pieces with him, things that he had written, things that he had arranged.
Really?
Lovely pieces. He played them with such charm and such elegance. Great lesson. Try to do that. Not just play big and soft. I mean, just do something nice. I figured that the way I was going to learn was to watch him play. I learned more by watching people playing and listening to them than I do from them talking. He never demonstrated.
Never demonstrated.
Except for me. I knew what I was in for. And I knew that I had very little time, and I wasn't going to be there very long. I was already, you know, 23, and what the hell? Kids running around like Joey Silverstein, he was 14 there, and I played quartets with him. Here I was 20, I was an old man in that place. So I wanted to get as much as I could in the shortest possible time, and then get the hell out.
Back to the symphony.
Well, back to something. He would sit in a chair like you are, and he'd be smoking a cigarette, always backwards. You had to have your lessons memorized. There was no music. You could have three lessons a week, and each lesson was a new something. You had to know it from memory. Well, I have a shitty memory. And anyway, I didn't like to practice that much. So I would come down. I'd go in a corner, I'd get the music down. You had to sit right in front of him when you played, incidentally. Like, I'd be sitting here, and you'd be sitting there. And I'd put a stand like this. Music there, start playing, and then while I was playing, he would take his finger, and while I was playing, he would just slowly start turning the stand, and I'd be going around like this. I said, I can't see it, and he said, Martin, you're lazy like old hell, and your cello is filthy.
And he would laugh, and you would laugh.
He wouldn't laugh.
Would he make you laugh? I mean, was his...
Was
he good humored, or was
he was
very
solid? He was. Well, you know, he talked like this. Martin, you are lazy like all hell, and your cello is filthy.
You don't have to be genius to know your shortcomings, but you have to be a mighty intelligent person to know your strong points. That is your obligation, to know what's good, and if possible, to enjoy it and convert everything that you don't like, to convert it to something that it is likable.
Is it true that he used to to come out with his cello up over his head. He used to sit down. Did he push his cello right into the ground?
No, big noise. No, he didn't do that. But he carried it very high.
Very high over his head.
Very high. It wasn't over his head. It was straight ahead. You didn't dare get in the way. I mean, it was high.
He was a big man.
He was a big man. Well, he had big bones. He had a huge face. And he had large hands. It's interestingly enough, he did not use like Slavic. Always kept his fingers close together.
Close together.
Never believed in stretching. He only wanted me to practice one thing. And that was changing all the fingers on the note, on the same note, but don't let anybody know it. It's got to sound like one note. Meanwhile, you're changing your fingers. He would substitute a finger rather than stretch. He had very big hands, but he didn't use it. So I studied Schumann, I studied a couple of divertimentos. I studied this stupid, wasted a lot of time on this Castelnuovo Tedesco thing, and I studied Dufour and Piatti. If you ever had a technical problem, he would assign a specific exercise, and his assistant would work you over with it. Like say, Shirley, make him practice Piatti number 3 or something like that.
All right, so he had done those. He had studied
those. He made them. Oh, yeah, and they sounded fantastic when he played them. He made concert pieces out of them. Played them twice as fast as normal.
I see.
As a matter of fact, he would sometimes play them as encores. You know that one, the octave one? He made me play that thing because I was loudly on octaves still at. And he played that thing at an incredible speed. But very light and lacy. I mean, it was really fantastic what he did.
Did he enjoy teaching?
He only taught you if he wanted to. He has always been that way. So anybody went to play for him, if he liked you, he would coach you. If he didn't like you, forget it. And he had to like you personally, too. I know one guy who refused to teach because he was of what he considered a low moral character.
So he got to know you personally a little bit?
A little bit, yeah. As a matter of fact, I remember, he was a great psychologist, too, and I was very shy. You might not realize, but I was very introverted. The thing that I learned from him was how to project. That's the thing I didn't know about. You know, you just play. You play to the music stand, or you play to the mic, or you play to the wall. But you got to play to the back, the last seat.
The last seat.
He was the one that brought that out, the idea of a bigger style and just thinking in little grander terms, you know, everything just a little bigger than life. Important thing is not to study with a guy like Piatigorsky until you know the instrument. And then you can get these finishing ideas. I think it's very important to study with an artist at some time. Somebody who's done it in front of people. Not like studying with somebody who's never done it. They know how to put across passages, good fingerings and all, and nothing is theoretical. It's been honed in the crucible of the performance, you know, and things are quite different.
He had an enormous sound,
No, very beautiful sound, but Slava has twice. He didn't have what I would call a big sound. He was the most elegant of the players. Things just rippled. I remember he came to my house once in Washington, and I was playing some concerto with the orchestra, and I said, you know, I've been working on this cadenza. And he remembered. But he said, I said, you mind showing me how you do it? And I dragged out my old box. And he said, I said, you mind if I turn on the tape recorder? He said, well, all right. And on the spot, he made up a beautiful cadenza. He said, I'd like to hear it back. Sometimes one is surprised by what they hear. He was very inventive, so musical. Yeah. Well, you know the story of the Haydn divertimento, that he arranged this divertimento from a wind piece that has three movements. And some critic wrote that the opening eight bars are one of the loveliest tunes that Haydn ever wrote. Well, Piatigorsky said, ha-ha, I wrote that.
You wrote that, you wrote that.
Listen, he played all little pieces better than anyone else. He had a charm and elegance. Now, he phrased within the phrase. Same age exactly. Boyman would dazzle with his brilliance and his sound and absolute sure technique. Piatigorsky wasn't that sure lots of times. He didn't practice much. He was telling me, John, he says, if you're clever, 2 hours a day is enough. I tried it, it didn't work. You talk about his sense of humor. I had an old 78 of a Saint-Saëns concerto which he played. It was the first piece he recorded here. Terrible. Just awful. I spoke to him about that piece. He said, oh yes, he says, I heard the oboe play the tune. And he said, I realized I was playing like a pig. And he said, I tried to have the record not distributed, he said, but they did it anyway, and after a while I was glad because it encouraged all the young cellists. It's the kind of guy he was, very philosophical. He was a very philosophical guy.
In order to know about something, you have to give all your life. Only to discover, it's not enough. But you have to live thousands of years, maybe, to know. And that is the most amazing thing, you know, there is the cello. Four strings, and yes, it was made by a genius, a Maestro Divari, but still, it is a wooden box, and it is amazing how all-encompassing in that thing that does not leave time practically for anything else. More than that, that one strives for without really achieving, but realizing that it took me all life to know and I don't know. And so that is constant, never-ending striving for something that's almost unachievable.
Somebody had a book, I think it was in Europe, and they entertained a lot of artists. And you would sign, and this one guy, I forget who he was a very famous cellist. Over his signature, he wrote the first few bars of the third Bach suite. All separate bows. And Piatigorsky came by a few months later and saw that, he was invited, and he wrote the thing out with all slurs and signed his name under it.
He did play in orchestras.
Berlin Philharmonic. He said, once in a while we play like two octaves higher. And the conductor never liked it because I usually played out of tune. I mean, that's the kind of guy he was. You have to remember, a good teacher points him in a certain direction and tries to wean him. I don't really think about anybody now. And actually, I think most of us, when you get to a certain point, you don't play something because your teacher told you that that was how it's supposed to be done. As a matter of fact, I didn't really learn how to play cello until after I started earning a living at it. And I realized that if I was going to eat, I was going to have to play. And I completely revamped everything. On details. Mm-hmm. I remember playing a bunch of little pieces for him, and he suggested diminuendos and crescendos and all that sort of stuff to just to phrase the thing. But he only would say it in a couple of places that you got the idea. If you were smart, you better re-examine your whole approach.
Anything of the right hand? Did he believe in a certain way to do the bow?
The only thing he ever told me, I don't think the thumb has to be so bent on the bow. He didn't like it so bent. I remember once he told me, he said, John, do you ever feel your right arm is too long? Because he was very big, and you know, you always had to fool around here, cock the wrist to, I mean, the closer the bridge is to you, the higher you play with the cello, the more you have to have a lot of angles. And so I was always messing around. I always played a high end sort of thing. But he all he ever said, he didn't say how to get rid of it. Right. He was sore that I left after 1 year. I got married and joined the orchestra again. He was always supportive of his pupils and always tried to get them a job somewhere. Never hesitate to recommend you if he likes you. And all through his life, he liked his pupils to correspond with him and let him know. And he, every time he came through Washington, he used to give me a lecture on wasting my talent. He said, John, he says, you look a little thin, and are you practicing? I mean, he's that kind of a guy.
Right.
Piatigorsky was more like a doting uncle. For instance, I was living on the GI. I lots of times actually didn't have enough money to eat. If I had any money, I'd buy a ticket for the Philly Orchestra or something like that, you know. And he would come in and he'd come in and say, John, do you need any money? You know, he always wanted to make sure that we were okay. His contribution for me was not technical. It was psychological. You don't play for yourself. Play for other people. It's like an actor developing a voice for the stage, not just for conversation, but project, that's the thing. Not only project the music, but you have to look halfway decent when you play, you know, and you're selling the music, you're selling yourself, and all that sort of stuff. Number two was the hard things must be made easy. He had a facility, a very nimble way of playing, very light and lacy. When he wanted to, he could play a Boccherini sonata and just fly over the instrument. It wouldn't be a big sound, but it'd be very clear and very charming. He was the kind of guy who, like Slavoj, had great presence when he walked into a room. He would talk very seriously like this, you know, and tell the most outlandish stories and wait for you to laugh. But he would keep a straight face. He would he would spin incredible stories. I remember when, this is the summer place, we would, you know, we'd have lunch together, something like that. I mean, it was a gang of us, just the students. And he would start telling stories. There was one about a dog that jumped out of a window and he broke his feet or something and he was going around. We were rolling on the floor, not feeling sorry for the dog, and the whole story was just, he was just making it up as he went along. And
nobody can really choose music as professional, like you can choose to become a dentist or whatever. It chooses you. So actually, from the beginning, you have a very little to say. You're taken by it.
And then there was another time he was directing us. There was a pig that had broken loose. It was running down the highway. A bunch of us went out to help the farmer catch a pig. Well, my God, you don't know what it's like to try to catch a pig. I grabbed hold of that damn pig and squirm away, you know, and he was having a ball, you know. He wasn't a backslapper. He had great dignity. And yet, he was, like I say, like an uncle, not like a father, but like a your best uncle. No, the compliments I got were always, he never told you to your face that you were good. He would tell you to your face if you were lousy. I was practicing something out there in the open farm field under a shed somewhere in the summer, and he came out and said, sounded good. I said, how far away were you? He says, pretty far. that kind of thing, you know.
Yeah.
You had to figure out the stuff yourself. He wanted you to be on your own. He was trying to make you so that you could continue without him. And he wasn't putting you in a mold. He was building a fire under you. That's really what it was.